970 KBUL, Tommy B, it's the Bulletin. NAMSENSE is the brilliantly written story of a combat squad leader in the 101st Airborne Division in the thick of combat during the Vietnamese War. The author was a 19-year-old kid from New England when he was drafted into the United States Army. It was 1968, and after completing various NCO training programs, he was promoted to sergeant without ever setting foot in a combat zone, then sent overseas in early 1969. Well, shortly after his arrival on the far side of the world, he was assigned to Camp Evans, the 101st Airborne northernmost base camp near the village of Phnong Dinh. It was only 30 miles from Laos and North Vietnam. Well, in addition to the 101st Division there, from 69 of April to March 70, he came home, started writing. You might have seen some of his stories, in fact, in Chicken Soup or some other magazines. His book is NAMSENSE, Surviving Vietnam with the 101st Airborne Division. Arthur Wiknik, Jr., my guest, back on the Bulletin. Artie, it's great to have you back. Good morning.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
I couldn't be more delighted to have you back for Veterans Day and us. And actually, I guess a few things have happened. A lot, in fact, has happened since we talked last.
Actually, it has. And I'm very pleased. The hardcovers came out in 2005, and they sold out. And then my publisher thought that it would be a good idea to try the paperbacks, and they just came out a few months ago. And as far as I know, sales are doing well, so I'm very pleased with that.
Yeah. Now, in addition to the book writing, now this has gotten you a certain amount of notoriety in that it's been a popular book. Now, you do, besides some interviews and radio shows and that kind of thing, some presentations, I would assume, in schools, right?
Schools, civic organizations, and anything that's local. If they need a veteran to talk about his experiences, I'm more than willing to go. I don't charge a fee because I don't think it's right to make money in that regard for just talking to kids.
Yeah. We're going to talk about Hamburger Hill, okay? And before I get there, though, well, the book. Why? Interesting that it took you a while actually to put the memoir down. Why?
Well, actually, when I first came home, I was a little disappointed because no one wanted to know what happened to me, what I went through. So I went on the offensive, and I started telling them. And the more people I told, they became interested. And somebody one day just says, you should write this down, make it into a book. I said, well, that's what I'm going to do. And over the years, I just kept writing notes down, kept talking to people, and keeping my thoughts together. And once I had it to where I thought it was saleable, I started sending it out to different publishers, and a lot of them rejected it for various reasons. So I just kept...
Really?
The writing was a little poor at first. It took me a while to get my skills nailed down, so I wrote a lot of letters to the editor. I wrote a lot of little short stories that appeared in some national magazines. I got a little confident in my writing, and then... So I went back and rewrote, and I went through 5 rewrites to get it to where I wanted it.
Really? Well, yep. I guess that's why it's so good. I mean, I have the softback now. It just arrived, and I got a chance to read it last night before we talked today, and I think I liked it better the second time around, Art.
Well, that's great.
Yeah. It's good. You say this in the publicity stuff all the time. Here's a book about Vietnam. There's no raping. There's not any village burning and less drugs than most Vietnam memoirs, I would think.
And that's because the guy, I don't know what went on in different parts of the country during the war. But I know the guys I served with were very upstanding. There's a few things that I want my mother to know, but But most of the stuff we did, we stayed away from the villages. We never bothered with the civilians. We didn't burn villages. We didn't rape anybody. There was a few guys who smoked pot, but not too many, and that was always in the rear, in the safe area. They would never do that out in the jungle. So it was pretty tame as far as what the media portrayed us to be. But again, that was the guys I was with. So either I was naive to what was going on, or I served with a great bunch of guys.
Yeah. Well, you're just a kid then. Huh?
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I had just turned 20 when I went to Vietnam.
Wow. And, okay, let's start there at the beginning with the first hooch and the first friend. Now, how do you say Howard's name? Is it Sinner or
Siner?
Siner. Howard Siner. And he's a Yankee fan.
He's a Yankee fan. He's from New York.
I love Howard, you know. I do. I love him. Apparently, you got along with him all right as well.
I made two very good friends over there. Howard Siner was one of them, and another fellow named Dennis Sillig, who unfortunately passed away a few years ago from cancer. But Howard and I talk to each other probably two or three times a year. We see each other because he lives, you know, about 100 miles from me. He's been a great, great friend and one of the best friends I ever had in the Army.
Mm, yeah. Okay. Well, let's start with Hamburger Hill then. Now, this was very shortly after you arrived. I mean, talk about getting right into the thick of things.
Right. I had absolutely no combat experience. We had been there for about a month. Or I had been there for about a month, and everything we had to deal with was little local ambushes where nothing ever happened. We'd find a few booby traps, and that was it. Never saw any action. And then we got called to help the 3rd of the 187th, who was embroiled in this Hamburger Hill battle for several days already. And we were not aware of it, but we were flown out there to assist. And when we flew over the area by chopper, you know, it's all mountainous and very green and you know, lush, except for this one location. You can see this brown area against the, you know, against that green backdrop, and you knew that's where the action was happening.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then the job was to take the hill.
Well, yeah.
Right?
In simple terms, yes. But what we did is we landed at an area about a half a mile from the hill itself, which was really is a mountain. It wasn't a hill, and we met a lot of other guys that had been there for several days. And what our job was all the other companies that were involved, we were assigned to surround the base of the hill, so no enemy soldiers could escape. And it took a day and a half just to do that, just to get people into position because of the terrain.
Oh, okay. Now, and you're an NCO now. I mean, so you're like a squad leader.
Correct.
All right. And when you charge up that thing, the great story. I mean, the way you write this, it just kills me. Because there was a shot in the dirt. It went in the shot dirt into your eye, basically. You thought you were actually hit at that point.
Well, yeah, what had happened is as we moved forward, I had never been shot at before, so I really didn't know what to expect. But I see guys running around and crawling and jumping behind stuff, and I don't know what the heck, you know, nothing's happening because there was a lot of shooting, but I thought it was just us firing suppressive fire, and I didn't know we were being shot at. And then I noticed this stuff was dirt was turning up around my feet. I said, "Whoa, I'm being shot at!" So then I crawl over to a spot and into a bomb crater, and I'm looking over the edges trying to figure out, you know, trying to find a target, something to shoot at, and then dirt got blasted into my eyes. And when I reached up, I figured I was hit somewhere. And when I reached up to protect my eyes, then a second round came in and hit me square in the chest and knocked me backwards. So now I know I'm a dead duck. I'm laying there, and I'm just figuring I'm going to drift off, and that'll be the end of me. And suddenly I can start to see a little bit. So, but in the meantime, my chest is killing me. So I get the dirt out of my eyes, I look down at me, and my bandoliers and my shirt is on fire. So I surmise, is that the guy shot me with a tracer round. It landed in my equipment, didn't penetrate my body, but it got landed in, because we had so much stuff we were carrying, so much ammo. And it landed in there, and it ignited. And I had to get that thing off of me before all my ammunition started to cook off.
Yeah.